Gonna be a good day. Well, this song that we just sang says, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. Amen. If you just look for the Lord in everything that you do, see his face, turn your radio on, your CD on, and listen to Christian music, your day will go from here to here quickly. When we see his face, and that this is what's going to happen. People turn. light shine in the darkness. Do you know what that does to darkness? One little light. That's all you need is one little light, and that chases the darkness away. Hallelujah. Also talks about shining your light. You see a pattern here? Christians need to shine their light. Without that, we have darkness. We have the next few songs that talks about worshiping, giving your heart to the Lord, and drawing me close to the Lord. These weren't three altar songs. I don't know what they are. If there's anyone here today struggling with anything, has loved ones who are not saved, wants that light to shine a little brighter, please, please come up to the altar. Desire, Lord. Oh, Jesus.
Challenges with every day, every way.
Jesus.
Apostle Paul says, I die daily.
Jesus.
What exactly does that mean? I think it meant that he was willing, if necessary, to die for the sake of Jesus. And I think that kind of resolve needs to come into our hearts and into our lives in these last days. I'm yours, Lord. Every piece of me, every bit of me, everything I have, everything I own, it's yours. It's yours.
That's right.
Take it. Do with it what you will. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the Word of God that gives us the wisdom, the understanding, the knowledge, the ability to be able to live a victorious life, to know that you are for us and not against us, to know that you have come to lift us up into heavenly places beside you. And so, Lord, we just thank you for the precious anointing of the Holy Spirit to give the mind of the Spirit this day to your people. In your name we pray. Amen. If you got your Bibles, open them up to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Or it'll be on the screen, I'm sure. Amplified. Paul's writing to Timothy and he says, but understand this, that in the last days will come and set in perilous times of great stress and trouble. Hard to deal with, hard to bear. For people will be lovers of self and utterly self-centered, lovers of money and aroused by an inordinate greedy desire for wealth, proud and arrogant and contemptuous boasters. They will be abusive, blasphemous, scoffing, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, and profane. They will be without natural human affection, callous and inhuman, relentless, admitting of no truce or appeasement. They will be slanderers, false accusers, troublemakers, intemperate, and loose in morals and conduct, uncontrolled and fierce, haters of good. And underline that in your Bible, haters of good. Not dislikers of good, haters of good. They will be treacherous, betrayers, rash, and inflated with self-conceit. They will be lovers of sensual pleasure and vain amusements more than and rather than lovers of God. For although they hold a form of piety, true religion, they deny and reject and are strangers to the power of it. Their conduct belies their genuineness of their profession. Void all such people. Turn away from them. And then if you drop down to verse 12, it says, indeed, all who delight in piety and are determined to live a devoted and godly life in Christ Jesus will meet with persecution, will be made to suffer because of their religious stand. But wicked men and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and leading astray others and being deceived and led astray themselves. But as for you, continue to hold to the things that you have learned and of which you are convinced, knowing from whom you learned them, and how from your childhood you have had a knowledge of being acquainted with sacred writings, which are able to instruct you and give you the understanding for salvation which comes through faith in Christ Jesus, through the leaning of the entire human personality on God in Christ Jesus, in absolute trust and confidence in His power, wisdom, and goodness. Every scripture is God-breathed, given by His inspiration, and profitable for instruction, for reproof, and conviction of sin, for correction of error, and discipline in obedience, and for training of righteousness in holy living, in conformity to God's will and thought, purpose, and action, so that the man of God may be completely and proficient, well fitted, and thoroughly equipped for every good work. It's kind of a bleak piece of scripture, you know, because in our hearts, we want to be optimistic. I think the Holy Spirit creates optimism within us, a belief that no matter what the situation, we can overcome, we can be winners. We're the head and not the tail. We're above and not beneath. But yet, there it's written. This is the way it's going to be in the last days. And so, if that's the case, I ask myself, well, first off, what can we do to protect, defend ourselves and that which is ours? And secondly, how did this happen? How did a nation that was founded on the principles of the Old Testament and the New Testament get into a place where in the end times it's going to be like this? How'd that happen? And, you know, as an American, we have a tendency to look at the world through the eyes of America. What is happening here? What is going on around the rest of the world? I have some mental images that I have a lot of problems with. Mental images from World War II, where people were lined up beside a ditch, and the SS walked behind them and shot them in the back of the head, and they fell over into the ditch, and they were buried there. I have some problems with mental images of people in orange jumpsuits being led along beside the sea, and there they were going to be executed. I have problems with the lawlessness and the wickedness that exists in this world, this hardness of heart, this callousness. But there was always a nation. There was always a place of safety. When these kind of things erupted, people could flee. They could flee to this place that had a statue in its harbor. And the accounts of people coming from overseas as they pulled into New York Harbor and they saw the lady of the harbor standing there, the emotion that welled up inside of them because they had come to a land of freedom. They had come to a land where opportunity was there if they wanted to seize it and take it, if they were willing to work, willing to save. That opportunity still exists because we see people, most of which have come from the other side of the world. They came from Vietnam. They came from Asia. They came to the west coast of this country, and there the freedom that is available still in this country was for them. And they were willing to live, 3, 4, 5 families in a small apartment, but they were willing to work and work hard. They insisted to their children that they would study and that they would learn, and they would grow out of that poverty that they had known in the land that they came from. And that freedom and that opportunity allowed them to prosper. Do you know that there are quotas in order to get into college? Did you know that? That they have established quotas by race? Do you know that the Asian race is limited with the number of kids that can go to college? because they excel so much that all of them would be able to get into college. And so the quotas that are there is kind of a reverse quota. By the way, I want to clarify something I said last week in a message. I said the walls around Babylon was so big that you could drive two chariots. I was reading this week, it was five. I just wanted to clarify that. Try to keep my facts straight. Okay, but this was a place of freedom. Why was that? It was because there were certain biblical values that was built in and inculcated into the heart of the culture. Even though not everybody went to church, there were times of revival where multitudes was swept into the kingdom of God prior to the revolution, and then during the second great awakening that took place in the 1840s. By the way, that's where the term preaching on the stump came from. They would just, people would just gather out in the middle of the Tennessee wilderness, and they would cut down trees, and there would be different preachers preaching in different places, and the preacher would just go and get on the stump. So he'd look over the crowd, and he would preach from the stump, from that great, second great awakening that took place in this country. I quoted last week, I think it was, from the Northwest Ordinance, where it said, schools being necessary, we're going to set aside a piece of property for schools in every township. And the purpose of that school was to teach religion, morality, and sound science, in that order. You can't have sound science without religion. And when our founders spoke of religion, they were speaking of Christianity. They weren't speaking of Mohammedism. They weren't speaking of Buddhism. They weren't speaking of Judaism. They were speaking of Christianity. Christianity, when practiced according to what Jesus taught, is the most tolerant religion ever on the face of the earth. What happens if somebody does not embrace Christianity? You go over to your neighbor and you say to your neighbor, Jesus is coming. He died for you so that you might be saved and that you can have eternal life. And your neighbor gives you some curse words, tells you to get off his property, and don't ever come back. Well, how do you handle that as a Christian? Do you go build a bomb in your garage and take it over and blow his house up? You go drag him out and cut his head off? Is that what Christianity does? Don't tell me. Don't anybody tell me that Christianity is not a tolerant religion. It is extremely tolerant. It's just that truth is truth and error is error. Right is right and wrong is wrong. If you choose to embrace wrong and if you choose to embrace error, it's going to unleash curses in your life. If you choose to embrace Jesus, who came to give us life and life more abundantly, then you're going to be blessed in your life. And so we as Christians are commanded to study to show ourselves approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightfully dividing the word of truth. See, you can take and do crazy things with Scripture. You can take Scripture out of context and you can beat people over the head with it, and you can make them feel unworthy. There's all kinds. You can control them with an authoritarian power using Scripture. Jim Jones used Scripture. Had the people drink the Kool-Aid. That's where that expression came from. Some of you might not be old enough to remember that. You know, every once in a while you hear somebody, are they drinking the Kool-Aid? Well, Jim Jones fixed up these big vats of Kool-Aid with poison in them down in Ghana, South America. And he got the people to drink. Almost 1,000 people died. They drank the Kool-Aid. Well, there's a lot of people drinking the Kool-Aid in this nation today. But it's not coming from the churches. It's coming from the Antichrist spirit that is at loose. And where are most people getting their information as to what is right and what is wrong today? They can get it from the internet, they can get it from the television, or they get it from the government schools. If you begin your life believing that there is no God, that we just came out of the primordial soup by accident. Now, I know every once in a while I talk about this, but I want you to think about this. I mean, I really want you to think about it. How did that happen? How did matter happen? He said, well, you know, all the universe was about the size of my thumbnail. And it really? And it just exploded and made the stars and made the planets and it made the earth. And then here you have this earth devoid of any life. And bolt of lightning hit some water, some soup, and life came alive. You know, Frankenstein tried that. Why do people buy a lie like that? Why do they turn off their mind? All you got to do is go out and look at a tree. What? Well, Joyce Kilmer wrote, I never saw a tree. You know, remember the poem you had to memorize? Look at the tree. Somehow it had to develop roots. Then it had to develop this system of, you got the pith, you got the wood, you got the bark, which protects all of the sap coming up through the roots, goes out into the limbs. Then you got the leaves. The leaves somehow developed an ability to create photosynthesis. How'd that happen? How is it that a bird knows how to build a bird's nest? How do they know that? How do these instinctive things that's built within creation, how does that happen? And how do you get from a one-celled, asexually reproducing amoeboid to a world of sexual reproducing creations? How does that happen? And it says in Genesis, in the beginning, God created them, male and female. I don't necessarily want to take your minds over into the gutter or anything, but just how did that happen? How did we get male and female? How did we get this one entity that has these things within its body that can receive something from another body and create another one of them? Where did that come from? That's not possible. That's why it says in Psalm 14:1, the fool has said in his heart that there's no God. And yet our children, 95% of them across this nation, have been trained now for years that that is a lie. That in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And that this other fabrication is the truth. And now if you go and if you read after some of your main former evolutionists, they're all going to tell you evolution just can't be proved. And so they're searching desperately for another explanation. And the explanation that the scientific world, so-called, is moving towards is possibly there was just living matter dropped off here by aliens. And we laugh. But you have to understand, they're not laughing. There is deception that is coming, that the whole world is going to bite into. And when you and I take a stand for the truth, they're not going to like you. In fact, what we just read said, they're going to hate you. And when that hatred turns into a legal, we're going to come and get you, what are you going to do? You're going to cave? Or you're going to say, no, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. He created Adam and Eve. He created them perfect. They sinned. Sin entered into the world. But God made a promise. I'm going to send a way of escape for you. Even though you disobeyed me, I'm sending a way of escape. And he came through a series of events in the form of Jesus. See, well, there's been many, you know, Jesus was Jesus the Christ. Well, he said, well, there's been a lot of Christ. Christ is just an anointed one, an anointed teacher. No, he was Jesus the Christ. He was the Lamb of God slain from the foundations of the world. It was Jesus. He came. He bled. He died. And he made the only way of escape from what is coming. Jesus said, don't be afraid of him that can kill the body. Be afraid of him that can kill the soul. We got to get toughened up. I know the Bible is full of wonderful promises. Wonderful promises. And we've had good teaching on how to possess those promises. Promises for our physical body. Promise for us to prosper. Promise for us to be in health. They're wonderful. And they are promises. And they are ours. But at some point in time, we're going to have to get tough. I want to read something to you, and I'll conclude with this. This is from the Legal Alert, which comes from the Christian Law Association that we have supported. It's put out by Dr. David Gibbs, Jr. And he preached what I consider one of the greatest messages I ever heard on the difference between conviction and preference. And he wrote this article. It says, transgender issues, laws about male and female bathroom usage, high octane elections. The headlines today seem surreal. While the Christian Law Association is here to stand with you, today's issues are some that our founding fathers could never have imagined. The climate of today's culture is repeatedly anti-God, but we have a responsibility, a duty, and a privilege to be heaven's ambassadors on earth and share God's truth with those around us. American Christians are faced today with a very frightening situation. More and more of them are being taken to court over matters relating to their biblical faith. No longer may it be said that America as a nation encourages religious liberty. The country now only reluctantly tolerates it. Faithful Christians might as well become accustomed to the courtroom because they're going to spend increased amounts of time there defending things that they have always taken for granted. Though religious freedoms have not been totally eliminated, they have been drastically reduced. The courts of America play by a unique set of rules that both satisfy and defy logic. These rules are set to ensure fairness to everyone. They demand honesty and consistency. They are meant to protect, but they also can be used to persecute. The problem Christians face today concern the matter of their convictions. In a great sense, the Christian's convictions are being put on trial in America. In many cases, the believer has not done so well. For a long time, the word conviction was a do-all, catch-all word, all too often used carelessly to justify actions and beliefs. Often, Christians explain why they do what they do by simply saying they are motivated by their conviction. For many, convictions have become a combination of Bible views with bits of personal interpretation and ideas added. That which we do not like, we form a conviction for. If we change our minds about a matter, we just change the conviction. There remains very little sacredness in most of the convictions held by the majority of Christians. Suddenly, all of that has been forced to change as Christians are faced with appearing before a judge and jury to prove their convictions, not to their satisfaction, but to the satisfaction of unbelievers. In the courts today, Christians do not have to prove that they're right, but they must prove that what they claim to be a conviction is true. Convictions and not merely preferences. I've come to the conclusion that Christians today are saturated with opinions and preferences, but are virtually empty of real convictions. First Amendment provides that Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, nor prohibiting the free exercise thereof. In layman's language, America is a nation with religious freedom. There's no state church, nor does the government dictate any one given belief upon the citizens. Have you ever wondered just how far this religious protection goes? Where do you draw the line? Hundreds of people in the last few weeks have called our officials to discuss the major issues happening in our country. Transgender issues permeate our society like never before. Some people draw the line at shopping a particular store, while others called to argue that they have no issue whatsoever. The question is, where do you personally draw the line? I'm going to skip on over here to something called the test of faith. Because the courts were faced with many cases involving beliefs and believers, the Supreme Court formulated a test to determine which beliefs would be upheld and which beliefs would not be honored or protected by the First Amendment. Ironically, the court established the test back in 1972 in a case that involved education. An Amish man by the name of Yoder, living in the state of Wisconsin, told the state of Wisconsin that he was no longer going to send his children to state schools beyond the eighth grade. He claimed that this decision was based on his convictions. The state of Wisconsin informed him he could not do that, and that he would have to send his children to state schools. Mr. Yoder again refused to allow his children to attend state schools. The state of Wisconsin persisted with his demands, threatening to sue Mr. Yoder if he would not send his children to public schools. He stubbornly refused, contending that it would be against his convictions to do so. Next, the state threatened to send Mr. Yoder to jail if he would not comply. He did not want to go to jail, but realizing the potential consequences, he again refused to bend his beliefs. Finally, the state told him that if it won the case, not only could he go to jail, but he could also lose his children. All he had to do was comply and put them in the state school. You can imagine the difficulty in being faced with such a possibility, but his beliefs still would not allow him to comply. The state of Wisconsin took Mr. Yoder to court, and unfortunately, he lost. The state of Wisconsin came to him again, insisting that he put his kids in the public school. Yet, even after losing the court case, Mr. Yoder could not obey because it was a matter of conviction. It did not matter whether a court said he was right or wrong. His children were not going to go to the state schools. Mr. Yoder discovered a very interesting thing. The state did not give up. He appealed, but he lost his appeal. Even after losing the appeal, the state of Wisconsin again told him to comply. Mr. Yoder refused. He took his case to the United States Supreme Court. There, the highest court in the land told Mr. Jonas Yoder, "You do not have to send your kids to the state school because the Constitution's First Amendment protects you." The Supreme Court laid down the test that was to be used in all subsequent cases to determine which beliefs are to be protected and which beliefs are not to be protected. The Supreme Court's test is an excellent standard by which our beliefs can be judged. So the question is, what is your conviction? With this, I'll remind you of the famous book, Pilgrim's Progress, written by John Bunyan. While in an English jail, he was in jail because the king said, "You can preach, but in order to preach, you got to get a license from me to do it." John Bunyan said, "Government doesn't license me to preach. My call to preach comes from God." He said, "Well, if you don't do that, you're going to jail." So for 13 years, John Bunyan was taken away from his family, from his children. Ever so often, a little note was shoved under his prison door, and all he had to do was sign and say, "Yes, King, you may license me to preach." Never did. Never did. The day has arrived where each and every one of us have to come to a conviction. Jesus Christ is who he said he was. I'm going to do what the Bible tells me to do. And if the government tells me not to do it, I will refuse to obey the government. Because Romans 13 says that government is there to protect and to defend the right against the wrong. And God is right. And society and culture can be wrong. Be strong. Be courageous. Have no fear. You are a warrior. Father, I thank you for those within this congregation that have put their reputations on the line, have taken their own finances and monies to go to governmental meetings, go to sessions in which people were being encouraged to stand for right. Lord, help us to know right. Give us a heart desire to search your scriptures, to search them, to know them, to know what they say, and then to become convinced. There is no other name. There is no other way. Where can we go but to the Lord? And Father, cause this church to ever be a lighthouse to the communities around us. Make us a blessing and give us backbones of steel. In your name we pray, Lord. Amen. Amen. God bless you.